Hi everyone! It's lunchtime.
And I am setting my timer to make sure that I don't go over.
And I have a situation. I have Kerbals on the Mun, and I have Kerbals in orbit around the Mun, but the station that's orbiting the Mun doesn't have enough fuel to get into a good orbit, and the Kerbals that are on the Mun don't have enough fuel to get home. They can get back to space, but that's all the further they can go. So what I want to do is create a new ship. And I want it to just ferry a whole bunch of fuel up there. So what I'm going to do is use a remote guidance unit. And this is a really big platform to be sailing with. So I want to have a really big dock. And one of the things that they've done is they've added a brand new docking ring to the game. The Clamp-O-Tron Sr. The result of intense costly development to answer the problem of how to make docking connections more sturdy. Thanks to the brilliant suggestion of the staff, why don't you make them bigger? Staff janitor. The public can now enjoy the sheer thrill of docking enormous objects in space. Well, that would be very nice. Let's make sure I've got the right side up. There we go. So that's going to be my nose. Now here's the question. Can I dock that to a conventional dock? Here's what normal docks look like. What's it going to be like to dock that when I get up into space? So here's what I'm going to do. I am going to make two spaceships. I'm going to make two spaceships dock to each other, get it into orbit, and then I am going to try docking the two of them and just see how it works. So first, I'm going to make my little tiny spaceship on top, and I need a advanced stabilizer. So today's workshop is going to be a little bit about how to build spaceships. Let's clear our pad. So here's our docking ring. Let's build this spaceship first. This is our main craft. So we have this thing, which is the actual piece of machinery that's going to control the ship. It includes reaction wheels, and they've got 1.5 torque. They've got pitch yaw and roll of 1.5. And it requires 9 electric charge per minute. Now, a normal control ring is going to have 20 pitch. And so 1.5 is just not going to be enough, really, for me to be able to. It doesn't have enough reaction wheels for me to be able to actually maneuver a ship in space or to keep one on target, on track. So I throw on an advanced stabilization system ring. And the description of it. After many years of research, Stadler Corp's rocket scientists discovered that Kerbal crew members can't be trusted to keep spacecraft under control. The advanced SAS module addresses that issue by correcting flight controls continuously. It is highly recommended that crew members are kept unaware of the presence of such a device, as experience shows that many Kerbals will see as challenging their flight prowess. And one thing I've learned is you have to be really careful when you turn that sucker on, because if you turn these things on at the wrong time at a flight, or like when I was landing on the Mun, if it's still on while you are trying to stabilize on the Mun, you are in trouble. And I'm going to take up a nice big tank. This has got 1,440 liquid fuel and 1,760 oxidizer with a total mass of 18 and a dry mass of 2. That is a huge freaking tank of fuel. And anything bigger than that, you know, there's one that's got basically twice that amount, and there's no way I can maneuver that in space effectively. Now, that big a tank takes a lot of power to get it moving. And I've got the Rockomax Skipper, which is 650 max power. But I think what I'm going to use is the Poodle liquid engine, which is a 220. And I think that once I'm far enough away from Kerbal, the Poodle is going to give me all the Delta V that I actually need. Now, we're almost done with our ship. I mean, really, it is this simple. We want to get some reaction control systems on here so that we can actually do some maneuvering. The reaction wheels are perfectly fine for moving forward, backwards, for stabilizing, pitch and yaw, things like that. But you need these reaction thruster blocks to be able to actually move forward and backward, up, down, left, right, things like that. Here's the other trick. These need fuel. So you could add a big tank like this, but these tanks weigh 3.4. And I'm really, really hoping I don't need that much fuel. These little tiny tanks are only 0.23. And so if I can add, let's just say, 8 of them in total, equally spaced around the ship, I think I'm going to have enough reaction fuel for just weeks and weeks and weeks of touring around trying to get things to line up. Now, the next thing is that it's dark in space. And so I want to put some headlights on. I'm setting my controls to give me 2 of them, like headlights. There we are. And now because it's dark in space, it's really hard to see what you're doing. So I'm going to give myself rear lights to light up the entire ship so I can pretty much see where I'm going. So there we are. Next step, we need electrical power for that. And I think that if I throw on a set of rechargeable batteries up here, that's good. And then let's just give ourselves fixed solar panes. Don't know where they are. Oh, there they are. Some fixed solar panes. These are the Oxstat XLs from Fusty Industries. The Oxstat XL solar panel is a simple panel with no sun tracking or deployment mechanisms. It's very light and cheap, extra large version, and it has a electric charge of 5.5 per second. So I'll need 2 of these to power the electrics on my reactor wheels and my controllers. And let's see, the control requires 18 electric. So we're gonna need 2 sets of these panels. I'm gonna set 1 set here. Probably, because only 2 or 3 of these, or maybe 4 of them at a time, are gonna be in direct sunlight. There we go. So now I should be able to recharge in as much time as I discharge my fuel. So there's my spacecraft, and let's just call this refueling tug. So this is basically the ship that I do want to get. Oh, I just deleted my ship. Let's see if I can get back. It only took 7 minutes. Let's see if I still have the untitled spacecraft. Untitled spacecraft, 2 parts. Let's do an undo. Does nothing. Crud. Well, let's build another one. This time I will just kind of go through really fast. Go. There's that. We put a ASAS underneath it. We give it a tank of fuel. And this is the tank of fuel that we do not actually want to use. As little as possible. We really want this to be the tank that we're delivering to refuel with. But I am going to put an engine on it because I may need to use some of that fuel just to get where I'm going. Put on 2 sets of reaction engines, the thruster blocks, and again we grab some reactor fuel. And once you start building ships up, you can put them together really fast. Go like that, and make a copy of it, like that. Now we're going to go and get our solar panels. 1 and 2. Now, the next question is going to be, how do we get this to orbit? And one of the things that's going to be happening with this getting to orbit is that I need to test how these docking plates actually work. I've never used one of these. So my plan is to send this ship up with another ship attached. That will be my docking test. There's those lights. And then a set of low intensity beams. The Illuminator Mark II, very, very low intensity lights, which basically are just going to serve the purpose of illuminating this ship itself so I can help orientate it straighter as I'm trying to dock. And again, this is my refueling tug, and this time I'm clicking the save, not the new. There, I've saved. So let's now build the experimental test ship that I'm going to be docking and undocking with. And all I need for that is a dock. That makes it really hard to see what I'm doing. It's remove that and put on a structural member so I have a little bit easier view of what I'm doing. There we go. And we'll take that off later once we're done. Then we need some sort of brains for this ship, and we're just going to use the smaller remote guidance unit, and we'll use the small inline advanced stabilizer, and then we need some propulsion. Not much. You know, in fact, we're not even going to put any kind of engine on this except the reaction engines. And we need this ship to be long enough that the reaction engines actually do something. You know what? I think all we need to do is be able to go forward and backward. I'm curious about how to build this so that it's long enough that I actually can maneuver it. All I need to do is disconnect, back up a bit, reconnect, and then I'll know whether or not I'm actually able to dock. So we'll do this. We'll just make it long enough that I can get some reaction jets on there, and we're not going to use any other kind of engine. Like so. Like so. And we need some headlights so we can see what we're doing. We don't need a lot of light. And so I'm just going to put two on the nose. Like so. And two down below to light the ship up. And then let's just give us a couple of batteries. Because really, we don't need very, very much here at all. Like so. And then, you know, I suppose if I put another docking ring on the bottom of it, that'll just kind of balance it out, make it look nice. Now, do I have everything I need there for a ship? I've got a brain. I've got an advanced control system. I've got reaction jets. I've got reaction jet fuel. I'm done. That's it. That's a ship. It's not much of a ship, but it's enough to test with. I'll be able to back up, turn around, see if I can actually successfully dock this thing in orbit. And now let's reset this. Right, okay. Now, let us build how we are going to get this thing into orbit. And we're going to do that with all available power. I'm going to move this up a little bit so I can add more stuff underneath. The core of our launch is going to be, the core of our two orbit is going to be the Jumbo 64 with a skipper liquid engine on it. There you go. That's how you get into space. And now, and I see everything stacking up properly over here. I'm not even going to go into that today because getting your ship to stack properly is in and of itself an extremely difficult subject. Now, let's put six more engines on this. So our stage one is going to be six of the 64s with, again, the mainsail engines. And let's also add some of these radial mount engines. One there, and two there. Let's make sure we're balanced. These are all vectoring engines, so we're going to have a good flight. The flight will stabilize itself, theoretically, if I have enough computers on board and enough reaction wheels. And then I'm going to put some struts on to stabilize this because that is a lot of... Ooh, that is not a good place to put that. That I don't want to be connecting to my vectoring rockets, rocket motors. So we'll go like that, like so, making a nice X. The game really does a pretty good job of figuring out whether or not the thing you're building can hold together. And then I want to put some more, I want to back up my stabilization systems with just inline reaction wheels. These each have 20 torque, and that gives me a lot of extra torque to get up there into space. Now, is that enough? Boy, I don't know. It should be. Let's save what we've done. I wonder if I could also add over the top of these. No, I can't. Whoop. Oh, did not want to do that. No. See if I can undo. There we go. Okay. Let's see if I can add solid rocket engines. Would solid rocket engines even get me off the pad here? Would they add anything? Let's try it. Whoop. That's not what I want to do. Let's go back here. Solid fuel boosters. This could be a complete freaking disaster. You could also put fuel, solid fuel boosters in place of these suckers. That would be very interesting. Okay, let's go to launch. Ha ha. So now this is where the rubber hits the road. I don't think those solid fuel boosters are going to do anything for me. I think I need to replace the radial engines with solid boosters to get them to actually do to get me off the ground. I like the solid rockets because they kick you off that pad super, super fast, and they get you a good amount of delta V right away, right out of the door. I'm willing to bet they're not going to do anything in this case, but let's give them a try. Turning on the lights, turning on the advanced stabilization systems. I like the lights on so I can see what's happening with the ship. That's actually a very pretty ship. Throttle is up. There is no in-cabin view because there's no cabin launch. Okay, fine. The solid boosters are doing nothing. The goggles, they do nothing! Revert to vehicle assembly. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to take those liquid engines off. And we are going to replace them with solid boosters. We're going to give ourselves twice the number of boosters. Throw those away. Throw those away. Didn't quite throw it away. And these things, let's get those right center line on the tanks. Throw away the second ones. So now we have lots of those. Reset our markers. There we are. We're good. Okay. Now let's try loading this up with solid fuel boosters and see how we do with those. A lot of theory here, a lot of experiment. I think that's about right. And then we go back over here and we grab some more engines. One and two. And I think the bottom is flat. Ooh, we're sitting on those liquid engines. I think the liquid engines can hold it. And these are quite square. Oh, there we go. Closer, better. Save, launch. So now we've doubled the number of solid fuel engines. We've halved the number of radial engines, but that's only reducing the number of total engines in space by a third. So if we can get off the pad with the solid engines, I think we're going to have a good flight. If the solid engines don't do it, we're just going to go back to having, you know, 18 or 24 engines, liquid engines on launch. And throttle up, stabilization systems live. Look at them go. Oh, that's gorgeous. Up it goes. 2 kilometers. Then it turns around and comes right back straight at us. La! Okay, let's revert flight to vehicle assembly. That's hilarious. Okay. Now we could try adding a third liquid tank or a third solid fuel engine. What would happen if we did that? Let's just see if we can make a copy of one. Oh, no, not really. Is there room in between there for another one? What if I use a coupler here? Man, it's really tight. This seems like a really, really, really bad idea. So let's do it. Get that lined up. And, oh, that is not really sitting on the mark. There we go. Like that. And you're kind of close to each other. Like that. Oops, let's get you all lined up. And you're a little bit higher than the other, so let's get you back down a little bit. I wonder what will happen. Let's try it. Who knows? Who knows what will happen? Man. So, again, these are not manned flights. These are all experimental. So let's just see what happens. If this doesn't work, I know I can take the solid boosters completely off and run the whole ship all the way up to orbit using. Oh, we're not sitting very pretty here right now. Let's get going as fast as we can. Yeah! Oh my gosh, it's working! We're launching! We're 10 meters per second already! This is insane! Awesome. Look at that. It's okay, let's throttle. Let's get everything ready for the liquid to come in. Because these solid tanks are almost done. And oh, it's a beautiful display. Wow, hit those mainsail engines and up we go. Mainsail engines, we are accelerating. This ship's behind us. Mild, they're a full kilometer behind us now. We are 4 kilometers above the ground. Rising. We're at 90 meters per second. That's a really good start. We're going to run the whole way on these mainsails, all the way straight up, and then we'll use the internal single 464 rocket wings with the mainsail to get into orbit to actually achieve the orbit. So for this one, all we want to do is push ourselves up as high as we can. We want this apoasis to go just as high as we possibly can. 8,000 doesn't even count yet. It's got to get up to 50, or we'll be scraping the atmosphere and we'll fall back in. We want to get this up. I'm seriously hoping for 100,000 meters on these. I don't know if we're going to make it. Let's check our stage only. We might make it. Oh man, those engines generate a lot of electrical power. Let's see, 14,000 meters per second, 200 meters per second, 30 meters per second. These engines used to overheat and explode. And so you can never really run them hotter than two-thirds throttle. That was interesting. Apple Oasis is now 75,000, getting 100,000 meters. 100,000 meters. These engines are really happy. They're really exceedingly amazing. This is a ship that can get to orbit every single time. And does that mean that we can start really adding some tanks up in orbit? And that means we might actually start building herbal to run space tugs that never actually land, but just going to refuel. Like I said, that 5 or 6 ships like this in a row. Here we go, and we are empty. Now, jettisoning, and we're going to slow down. I just want to pull away from those tanks so I don't hit them. It is not only possible, but rather easy to smash yourself into your empty tanks if you're not careful. And we're 1,300 meters per second, and let's see. Have I gone in a retrograde orbit? I might have. I might be in a retrograde orbit. We're going to position for orbital burn. And that basically means I need to turn the ship 90 degrees to starboard. Slowing. And hack, and then I turn back on the automatic stabilization system and let it handle it. Our liquid fuel is still good. Let's see where we're going for orbit. That's going to be our burn. And what I want to do initially is just get into orbit. And let's see what that burn looks like. That's a lot of kilometers per second. We need to get her. Oh, whoa. That's all. No, we don't want that. We'll play it by ear. we'll just do it. Here we go. Burn. I mean, if I was refueling, if I was trying to join up with, what is all that trash I've got? Oh, those are my station probes that I dropped off. If I wanted to refuel the communication satellite, you know, then I'd be all set. But no, I'm just gonna get up here now. Ooh, I could rendezvous with the Hathorn Explorer. If this flight works, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to rendezvous with the Hathorn Explorer and get it out to the Mun as well. So, burning, I'm just burning. All I'm trying to do is get this into a circular orbit. And yeah, the Hathorn Explorer is going to be my target. But the main experiment is I need to decouple this ship up here, this little robot up on the front, and see if I can redock. Oh man. Swaying back and forth really bad. Refueling tug debris 20 kilometers behind us. Falling back. I suppose I could turn on my RCS and it would do a better job of keeping us on the hack, but I think we're doing okay. In fact, I'm really, really pleased with this. This is really working really, really well. I'm hoping to get an actual orbit. I know I'm at 28 minutes. I'm gonna get this into orbit, though. I'm hoping to get into orbit, an actual circular orbit around Kerbin, without even touching my actual cargo tank. And then if I can do that, I can send tankers up here to this orbit. And, basically fly every flight exactly the same way, and they'll all end up in the same orbit, hook them all up together, and then I have my central refueling station from whence I can send other tugs out to rendezvous with other craft to refuel them. How is my orbit doing? I don't know what the plane of my orbit is. Looks like I'm pretty much straight on. Little high. Little angular, but that's an easy correction. That's a very easy correction. Ooh, we're at 18,000 meters per second. That's really close to where we want to be. Oh, yep, we are ending up with our Apoasis sticking way out. 24, 30, 40,000 meters. 60,000 meters, we have achieved orbit. And I'm going to see if I can push this out using the launch tanks to the Hathorn Explorer. That would be choice. That's it. We're done. Tanks are empty. We have done it. We have made it to orbit. And we are all done with you, tank. So I'm going to lower the throttle, jettison that Aquamax tank, and now fire up the engines on the refueling tug. Going to pull out a little bit. Bye-bye. Leave that tank far behind. There we go. That's good. Now, here's the deal. I have just enough time in this recording to see if I can actually do this. Let's first check. Solar panels are getting enough sun. Let's make sure the ship is viable. Energy flow is good. It's 3.6, so I've got 1, 2, 3 flowing at 3 and 4, and my consumption is about the same, so I think I'm actually doing really well. I'm going to decouple this node. There we are. Now, we're going to turn on the RCS. We're going to back up a little bit. Back up a little bit. We're going to change spacecraft. Not that one. How come I can't change to the... There we go. Here we are. Now we're on this spacecraft, and I'm turning on the advanced stabilization system. I'm going to back it up slightly. Just a bit. That's good. That's good. Change back to the refueling tug. Mark this as my target. Now let's see if we can dock. How is docking? We go forward. 1 meter. I don't have a good camera view. Okay, see, looking at my gimbal, I think we need to go a little bit to the right. A little to the left. Stabilize. 3.5 meters, 3.4 meters. And very curious how this is going to actually work. Really well lined up. Really well lined up. It's not too bad. Looking around the side of it, I was worried that because that nose is so big, I wouldn't have a really good view of what I was doing. Let's get back on target. Going a little bit fast. A little bit fast. And do we dock? I mean, does this have to hit dead on? Or is it anywhere in there that we're good? Nope, we're not docking. Dock. No, this is actually rather difficult. Come on. Nuts. Does this not want to dock? What is going on here? Let's switch ships. Okay. You are my target. Why can't I dock? Okay, we're gonna go to the up to the right a little bit. Down. Just a bit. The ship is backwards from what I'm expecting. That's down. Ah, the controls are backwards of what I'm expecting. Okay, dock. I can't dock. Come on, dock. Freaking dock. I don't understand. Did these not dock yet? I can't dock. Whew. Whew, that is really weird. Okay, that ship is useless. I'm gonna revert the flight back to the assembly and forget it. I'm not gonna use those docking ports. They don't work. That's really disappointing. Well, that was good science. Okay, so I know that this ship can make it to orbit really handily, and that those docking rings, I'm gonna have to read up about those on the wiki. I can't freaking dock with that ring. I wonder if it only mates to a ring of its own size. I suppose I could try that. I could try replacing this ship with an exact replica of that. That's what I'm gonna try that offline. This is it for this recording. Good science. Failed, but still good science. And talk to you guys later. It's above all, if you're not having fun, you're not having fun. So it's good to have fun. I'll talk to you guys later, because that was fun. I enjoyed that. Later.